Hello and welcome. My name is Kennedy Hill, and I am currently a junior at the Gallatin School of Individualized Study here at NYU. And I'm currently focusing on studying the intersections of art and politics. I would like to thank everyone for coming to tonight's dialogue, Machiavelli's Advice to Citizens on How to Choose a Leader, a continuation of our Inside American Politics series. Thank you to our speaker, Professor Stephen Holmes, for joining us. Stephen Holmes received his PhD from Yale in 1976 and taught briefly at Yale and Wesleyan Universities before becoming a member of the Institute for Advanced Study at Princeton University in 1978. He later taught at Harvard University, the University of Chicago, and Princeton before joining the faculty at the NYU School of Law in 2000. Holmes' research centers on the history and recent evolution of liberalism and anti-liberalism in Europe, the 1787 Constitution as a blueprint for continental expansion, the near impossibility of imposing rules of democratic accountability on the deep state, the traumatic legacy of 1989, the difficulty of combating jihadist terrorism within the bounds of the Constitution, and the international laws of war. In 1988, Holmes was awarded a Guggenheim Fellowship to complete a study of the theoretical foundations of liberal democracy, and in 2003-2005, was named a Carnegie Scholar for his work on Russian legal reform. Besides numerous articles on the history of political thought, democratic and constitutional theory, state building in post-communist Russia, and the war on terror, Holmes has written several books, including The Cost of Rights, Why Liberty Depends on Taxes, The Matador's Cape, America's Reckless Response to Terror, and The Beginning of Politics. I would like to once again thank Professor Holmes for joining us and sharing his valuable insights on these topics. Thank you.
I'm going to try to stand up, but I have a very bad cold, unfortunately, so there may be a certain point in which I collapse into this seat, but it's great to be here. Thank you for inviting me. And it's going to be a kind of a funny talk. It's a commentary on a 500-year-old text, but related to contemporary events. Now, after I agreed with Ellen on the name of this talk, How to Choose a Leader, I found there was a book just published now by Maurizio Viroli, who used to teach at Princeton, called How to Choose a Leader, Machiavelli's Advice, which I did read, and it's okay. But I'm not going to, if you read the book, it's going to have almost nothing to do with what I say, because we have a different view. Now, Machiavelli lived in, you know, quite a different time. The political reality was different in many ways. For example, no TV, which seems to dominate our political life. That's an obvious. But on the other hand, there are so many small details in Machiavelli's writings that are resonant with what we're observing every day. And of course, when I say observing everyday politics, I mean the election right now in the United States, because I'm obsessed with that, as probably many of you are too. For example, the idea that no matter how many good advisors you have, it doesn't help if you don't have any judgment and you're not prepared. So this is a very strong Machiavellian. I have a very great story on this about advice. This is one of Machiavelli's main themes about the impossibility of a person taking his advisors replacing his own judgment, because of course your advisors will disagree with each other, and then what do you do? So the story goes like this. It's a story about Yitzhak Rabin, who is, when he was prime minister, and he had been a general in the Israeli army, and a general came up to him and asked him, there's a bridge in the north, I want the permission to take a bridge. And he said, General, that's nice, I know that bridge, I fought up there, and there's a hill over the bridge, and it's useless to take the bridge if you don't take the hill. So you're actually asking me, can you take the hill? And the answer is no. So that's it. If you have no background information, you can't even understand the question you're being asked. So advisors, people say, well, if one of our candidates will remain unnamed, is elected, he'll have good advisors. This doesn't help, actually, because your advisors don't agree with each other. So this is a very strong, central Machiavellian theme, obviously highly relevant. What other kinds of things have encourage me to think that I can mine the texts of Machiavelli for insight today. One of his ideas, one of his very strong ideas, is that when someone has been very successful behaving in one way, and situation changes, and they need to change personality, instead of being audacious, they need to be cautious, or something of this kind, they can't do it. I mean, you know, it can be in your interest. It's like a horse. There's a horse, and there comes a flood. Now, it would be in the interest of the horse to become an eel, you know? But he can't become an eel. He's a horse. He can't. So there are certain people who have a certain personality, and also they are so intoxicated with the success they have had behaving in a certain way, you all know what I mean, they can't change, even though they should be acting, let's say, presidential or something of this kind. It's not possible because they intuitively, they feel they were successful the other way. So that's a very strong, one of Machiavelli's main themes, obviously very relevant to understanding the current debate. Another one that's is you can't, rulers have a hard time seeing themselves. It would be better to see them, you have to see them from the point of view of the people underneath them. Like, we should see Donald Trump from the point of view of Miss Universe or something like that. You have to see him from another point of view. And that's a very position he can't take very easily. So he calls it seeing the mountain from the plain. Very hard to do. But this is one of the reasons why people on top sometimes have a very hard time with self-knowledge. So many other topics, corruption, that is the shameless use of public office for private purposes, one of his big topics. And then particularly there's there's a phrase which I love and I want to come back to at the end. Well, this is one of Machiavelli's main ideas, and it goes like this: un principe che può fare ciò che vuole è pazzo. So if a prince, a leader who can do whatever he wants is insane. And that is, who has no limits, who doesn't obey the law, who doesn't follow rules, who doesn't realize that there are limits. Un principe che può fare ciò che vuole è pazzo. I'm going to come back to that, and that seems to me is quite relevant to understanding today's politics. Now, Machiavelli wrote, his times were different than ours, of course, but there's something similar, which is he was living in a time of great international regime change. He was coming out of these medieval cities, walled cities, which were republics, which were governing themselves, and there was a new age on the cusp of nation states with large armies, with mobile field artillery that made these walled cities indefensible. So basically, he's an Olive Minerva kind of character. He's living in a time of great change, and we are too. There's something that's changing. The whole post-World War II order is coming to an end. Europe is unraveling. The U.S. is going down in its internationally, and China's rising. We know the world is changing radically, and I think his insights, there's some way in which there's a reverberation in his thinking. It's not quite clear in his mind. He doesn't understand exactly where things are going, but part of the vibrancy of his thought is he's living in a time of great change. Even though he wrote his main book, his famous book, is The Prince, and of course, he wrote the discourses, which are about republics. The two books are basically the same. There isn't a great difference in his analysis. But the point about princes, the point that's relevant to us, is we have in the U.S. a presidential system, and a presidential system has a touch of monarchy in it. It isn't like parliamentarism. Presidentialism is a political system that can be analyzed in many ways similar to a prince. I mean, he says there is such a thing as a prince who is chosen by the people. There are two kinds of princes that are chosen. One are chosen by the nobles and one are chosen by the people, or chosen by the rich, chosen by the 1%, chosen by Wall Street, chosen by Goldman Sachs, versus those who are chosen by the people. And I think this still is a prince. There are princes who seize power militarily. There are sense of princes who do it other way, who inherit power. But there are princes who are chosen by the people. And the question then is, why would people choose, you know, how to choose a leader? Why would people choose a leader that maybe isn't so good from the point of view of any kind of objective standard? The background, the almost fundamental principle of Machiavelli's political sciences is that, and the reason Machiavelli would say himself that his analysis would be relevant to us, I think he would claim that, is that human passions do not change over time. That is, human passions are basically the same. Anger, love, fear, hate, envy, ambition, hope, avarice. These are all very strong human motivations, human passions. They motivate human behavior in all times, in ancient times, in medieval times, in Renaissance times, today. And that political competition, particularly winner-take-all political competition for the highest office, is highly emotional. You know, it isn't something that's a rational choice theory, talking about people calculating. It's highly emotional. You know, people are driven in their passion, they're thin-skinned, they're subject to humiliation, they're prideful, they are embarrassed. So you can't understand the behavior if you don't understand anything about emotions. If you think human beings, if you're an economist and you think human beings are featherless bipeds that have utility functions, you won't understand the emotional quality of these kind of political competition, which is, I think, very, very strong. And it helps us understand how someone like Trump can be so attractive. He's appealing to something very deep. He's not appealing to people's interests. He's appealing to something deeper, like humiliation or pride or wounded feelings or resentment or anger or frustration. And in fact, I think it's one way to put this today is that it's not actually that people are irrational voters, that Trump voters are irrational, but if you are unable to vote your interests, you will vote your passions. And unable to vote your interests in the sense that you vote, no matter who you vote for, you get the same policy. So you say, well, what's the matter to vote? This doesn't make any difference. I vote and then markets vote, or I vote and then the banks vote, or I vote and then Brussels votes. So you feel like your vote has no effect. So when you feel like your vote has no effect, you start voting not your interests, but your passions. Like, I'm so mad, I'm gonna send a message. It's what we call middle finger voting, or we call. That's what my son calls middle finger voting. And Jamie, and it's or bafaculismo in Italian. Basically, a voting in order to express your anger, your resentment, and this is a very powerful resource. And you know, Trump's genius is the alchemy. He's an alchemist. He can turn public emotions into political support. It's like an amazing thing to do. These are political emotions. Resentment, anger, humiliation, feeling like a loser, feeling lost, feeling like you have no future. People who, the high-tech global world with no factories, jobs left in it, with only Starbucks and McDonald's jobs and so on, feel with no future, feel like they have no place to go, are angry. The Brexit voters, or this kind of thing. Voting, not really thinking about the consequences, but wanting to send a message, wanting... After you voted for years and nobody listened to a thing you said, finally you say, here's a chance, I can vote, I can participate in voting, and people are gonna be shocked. I figured out what the entire elite, including the Republican elite, does not want. And I'm gonna do it, because that's gonna blow everything up. Now why? Is it because I have a calculation that this will help me in some way? No, you're not thinking that way. It's not that kind of thing. This is something that is, people just don't want me to do. And it means when I do it, it'll have an effect. I'm gonna have an impact. Finally, I'll have some impact. Like the Brexit voter, having an impact. Whether it's not the what impact, you know, that after the Brexit vote, that was the most common thing people were Googling for. What is Brexit? What is the EU? And things like this. But they knew that it was something people didn't want and people didn't expect. They knew it was an intuitive sense that this is, I mean, you watch Fox, you know, even Fox, the Republican establishment does not want this guy at all. And he's a rebel, he's a usurper. For them, he's a usurper. He's a person who came in, he took away their, and it's like, it's a shocking, what did the Republican Party stand for? They stood for family values, that's not Donald Trump, if you notice. Religion, constitutionalism, anti-Russia, like everything they believe, that he doesn't believe. And he managed, they had lost any emotional contact with their voters because they had promised them things that they didn't deliver, like stopping Obama, whatever. And he figured out that he could appeal to race, guns. I mean, something very primordial. Sorry, I'm going to get around what it is exactly he's doing. But he took them. He took them away from the Republic, these voters, making you wonder, you know, what is the landscape, actually? What is the psychological landscape of our two-party system? And actually, this is the biggest question for the U.S. is, what's the consequence for our political structure? Because the basic reality of the U.S. for hundreds of years now has been the two-party system. It's not people, there are people who join UFO clubs and things. That's not that important. The party system has been important. But now we have a time where the parties seem to be fading, and we have basically anti-party candidates, not just Trump, but Bernie Sanders and Obama. It's basically, it's like not really coming out of the party, center of the party. And there's a sense the parties don't speak to us, they don't represent us, they don't, and we're not enthusiastic about them, we don't care. And you can't have a democracy. I mean, there are various things that democracy requires. One thing is political parties. Another thing is you can't have democracy if one party is accusing the other candidate of being a criminal and who should be put in jail or maybe executed. That's what the Republicans say about Hillary, and then the Hillary people, like me, would say the other candidate deserves to be in a madhouse. So that's, you can't have this kind of way of viewing the other party. That's not, democracy can't work that way. So there's something really off going on here, and it's highly emotional, for sure. I don't want to make Machiavelli into, he's not a partisan hack. I mean, I'm not Machiavelli. He's much more detached. I mean, he's got his strong commitments to Republican politics, but he's much more interested in why things happen, explaining things. So he does, I mean, he says certain things that would be, I don't know if you want to call them positive toward Donald Trump, but he says one thing he says very strong is, you should always be generous with other people's money. So that's a very good I had that experience when my son, who I just mentioned, was your age, and I was living on campus, and I got a telephone call from a credit card company saying, Mr. Holmes, your order of 3 dozen red roses can't be delivered today because something happened. That was my son. He had a romantic moment with my credit card. So it was like being generous with other people's money. That's a very Machiavellian thing, and of course Trump has done that beautifully. What else he kind of thinks? Machiavelli says, some of the most successful rulers are those who break their treaty obligations with other states. So here we have Article 5 and NATO. So you wonder, so there are things in Machiavelli that Trump could cite and say, see, this shows you that I'm on the right track. But I'm going to leave most of those. I will stress rather statements like the following. Here's a good one from the Prince. You guys have studied a little Italian, right, somehow? We're all doing that. I uomini mutano volentieri, signore, credendo migliorare, di che si ingannano, perché vengono poi per esperienza avere peggiorato. People change their rulers happily. They get a new one. They want something new. People want something new. This is a bias. You want something new, and you think, because you don't like what you have, status quo, you want to change. But before you change, you better figure out, you have to think ahead. And that's not that easy to do. So there is such a thing as just a desire for change. And we know part of the situation today is, even if Trump is the candidate from hell, Hillary is the candidate from yesterday. She's just yesterday. It's just old. We've seen it. It's like too much. We want to change. And I think one of the things about democracy is at least you can, there's something different. I don't have to look at that guy all the time. You imagine what it's like to live in Russia where you have to watch Putin every year for the next 15 years. Horribly stifling. At least get rid of it. Have a new face. It actually makes, strangely, why should it matter in your daily life? It does matter to change. So people want to change, and for Machiavelli, this is it's irrational. It's something you can see that humans do, and they think they're going to make things better, but in fact, it doesn't necessarily. In this context, this is an example of whether or not, what kind of judgment ordinary people have, because how to choose a leader, what is happening in the mind of people when they choose a leader. So he says, Machiavelli does, that sometimes there's a famous passage where he says, the voice of the people is the voice of God, and people, if they're presented with two arguments, will always figure out which one is right, and they can judge well. So that's part of his thinking, is that because he is by a nature a Republican. He hates the elites, and he thinks you can say the il popolo has bad judgment, but elites have worse judgment, and rulers are stupid. People are stupid, but rulers are even stupider. So he thinks you should be fair about judging whether people are right or wrong. But he definitely at some point says more or less the judgment of the people as a whole it tends to be okay. On the other hand, he says the opposite. And which he says, gli uomini in universali giudicano più agli occhi che alle mani. So usually people judge by what they see, not by what they touch. Only a few people are close enough to the ruler to touch him. Only the people who know, everybody who knows Donald Trump said, Mike, you can't possibly have this guy as president. It's like, it's impossible, if you know him. But on TV, television, and this is presidentialism too. Presidentialism means the people who vote for the person who's going to be the president don't know him. Parliamentarism means the people who vote for the prime minister know him. They've known him their whole political career. They've seen the person in action. They see how they relate to colleagues. They've been in the room with them. So it's much fewer people decide, but they decide on someone they know. So is that less democratic than having everybody decide on someone you don't know? And you all saw a TV commercial, and you've listened to slander about the other candidate and all kinds of false stories and television. You know, we have, our constitutional system assumes that the press is a check on power, but the television is just an amplifier of lies. As far as you can tell, there's a guy, you got a candidate, he's lying and lying and lying, and there's so many lies you can't even correct them, and then they seep into the system and people feel the whole thing is dirty and it must be true. That's judging by the eyes and not by the hands. So this is a problem with democracy, I would say, judging by the eye. He says, ognuno vede quello che tu pari, pochi sentono quello che tu sei. Everyone senses what you seem to be. Your people are easy to trick with appearances, basically. So this is part of, how do you judge a leader? Well, actually, the way leaders are judged is by appearances, by him, what they seem like. And this is not necessarily right now. Joseph Schumpeter, who is one of the great 20th century intellectuals and economist, was Austrian, moved to Chicago and then Harvard, I think, yeah. Yes, he did. And he has a great line, which is relevant in this case. He says, you cannot fool all of the people all of the time, but you can fool enough people for long enough to do irreversible damage. So this is, and an election is like that. An election is one day. An election, this is a strange thing. Everybody knows if you have an election 2 months before or 2 months afterward, you get a different outcome. So why is it the voice of the people? I mean, voice of what? The voice of the people that day. So why should we honor something that's so unstable, that's so ephemeral? It's like, and this is something we must respect as if it were the highest authority, but it's not. It isn't authority at all. It's a whimsical, event-driven, unstable, and you can make irreversible damage. You can have George Bush elected president, and we have the Iraq War, and then you have the 2008 collapse of the world economy, and so on and so on. One little vote. And he didn't even win the election. The Supreme Court putting the man in power, irreversible damage. So we are living in a world where damage can be irreversible, and democracy is. I think election is like that, and particularly when you have the president. The president of the United States is an enormously powerful office. And it is not, you call it an institution, but you study this as an institution. It's an institution, but it's very porous to the personality of the person in it. You have a different person, you're going to have a completely different office. It's like, like Dick Cheney wasn't even president, have a very different office with the personality of the person. And so putting someone there, we have unilateral actions that a president can do that can be very, devastating. This is an advice book. The prince is in a book of advice. And he talks, as I already said, about advisors and why you can't, you don't know how to take advice. He says there are three kinds of brains. There are those who understand things themselves, those who can understand it if someone tells them, and those that can't understand anything. and they don't understand others or themselves and so on. And this is his kind of analysis. But the first thing he says about advisors is when you meet a leader, the first thing you should look for is who is he, who's around him, who are his advisors. That's the best way you judge him, because then you see what his judgment is. You can't just look at a person and see what judgment he has. But if you see he's asking James Woolsey or these kind of people who are complete lunatics, you see the people around someone, who are his advisors? Now, it's not that this is completely compatible with his claim earlier that advisors can't make up for the lack of preparation of a ruler. But still, you can judge something by who he surrounds himself with, Giuliani, Newt Gingrich, and so on. And these are, I think that's a very strong indication. How you should choose a leader, here's actually a piece of advice. Look at who he surrounds himself with, he or she surrounds himself with. And this is one of the big differences between Trump and Hillary Clinton. Hillary Clinton is a member of the Democratic Party, and basically, you know, she's, I don't know how you want to describe that, but basically she knows everybody in the Democratic Party, everybody who's an expert on anything, domestic and foreign policy. So it's a huge, but it's an institution. It's not people she met in the elevator. When Bill became president, it was more like that. And when Obama became president, it was like that too. Who I knew in Chicago, who was right there. It was like the little group. Obama brought his little group from Chicago, but that's not Hillary Clinton. Hillary Clinton is really part of a party machine, which has people who are experts in every area. And who are the people who she's talking to or influencing her policy opinions. Another of Machiavelli's questions is, when someone, he talks a lot about a new prince. In fact, his whole book, The Prince, is about a new prince, someone who comes from a private station to a situation of power, like Donald Trump would fly. A person like this can fly to power, but then what does he do when he gets there? It's maybe easy to get there, but very hard to do anything when you're there. What do you do? And so that's one of his questions. How will a person react when they're in this, when they go from a private station into a public station very quickly? And in this case, when we ask how, when we understand what he has done, what he's doing to fly into office, if that's what happens on November 8th, then we can understand what the difficulty will be if he is president. So this is a kind of Machiavellian understanding of that process. Why are people, what is his magic? Why is he, how would Machiavelli explain his magic, his ability to get people to follow him? He says, his phrase is tirarsi dietro il popolo. What is it that allows Trump to attract people? What's going on? And his basic idea is this. If one of the main emotions in a society that's corrupt, that means a society that's highly unequal, in which the poor feel left out and not represented, is anger, frustration, humiliation. And the best technique for gaining power is to allow people to vent their anger at someone they can blame for their humiliated state. So this is, and there are many examples of this, Agathocles, being able to channel resentment of people at a hated group. And these can be Mexicans, Hispanics, in general, Muslims, blacks, women. So blame someone. Now, even though, I mean, this is none, that's not, because in Machiavelli, there's no racism in the analysis in Machiavelli himself. And for Machiavelli, it's always the people feel oppressed by the elite, the noble, I nobili, i grandi is what Machiavelli calls it. And the populist dictator or the populist leader is the one who can channel the hatred and the desire of ordinary people to see the elite that looks down upon them attacked and hurt in some way. Now the greatness, I mean the genius of Trump, in my opinion, is that he takes this sense of inequality, futurelessness, no jobs, being left out of the world economy, and he turns it not against Wall Street like Bernie Sanders tried to do, but against immigrants. And so that the following statement is one that you will notice is shared in both America and Europe. And that's the statement, it's not our country anymore. I feel like it's not my country anymore. There are people coming in. Listen, Britain, Brexit, it's not my country. Look at these foreigners coming in here. It's not my country. And you can use the sense we're being invaded. There's an immigrant tsunami. They're taking over. They're erasing our identity. Our patrimony has been stolen from us. We're being erased. We're a white lump of sugar dissolving in a black cup of coffee. Something is being, our identity is being crushed in some way. This is a very emotional way of thinking. You know, my identity is being, but it's a channeling of anger at someone to blame. But it's, of course, channeling it away from, and the thing about Trump is he's making policies that aren't going to help ordinary people. The policies, I mean, he has fantasy policies, you know, build a wall, you know, if everyone who comes, are you a Muslim or not, you know, so they ask you at the, and then if you lie, I don't know what they do. He's got these fantasy promises. But even then, you don't, the voting, I think this is very important for understanding him, and it's kind of been confused by television attempts to fact check. You can't fact check Trump. It's like facts are irrelevant. When he says something, saying something like Hillary founded or Obama created ISIS, you know, this is not a cognitive statement. It's just like smashing her in the face or punching her in the face. It has no cognitive content. It's just, and people who want to smash her in the face like it when they hear it. It doesn't, you know, trying to understand the logic of what he says misses the emotional quality. For example, in the debate, he had this great argument. It was my favorite part of the debate the other night where he said, Obama should thank me. Why? Because I said in 2015 that he is not a citizen. And this forced him in 2011 to release his birth certificate. So, you know, figure that out. This is like a, you know, it's not, this isn't a cognitively coherent, it's not a thought, actually. It's just a, you know, sounds like I hate him, you know, whatever. He's not, it isn't something you can analyze in these terms. And I think, as we've been talking about, I think the experience of that debate doesn't really, the people who like him, who support him, aren't, probably were mad that he was humiliated by a woman. That was like the worst thing that could happen to someone like that, but are not, that didn't make them, the fact that he's incoherent, saying things that make no sense, doesn't really bother them, because that's not what they're being appealed, what they're appealing, what appeals to them is that someone who's standing up and saying, he's the Caesar of the losers, or something like that. I'm standing up for you, and I'm going to beat up those people, and it's all their fault, and this is the other, I think it's so crazy. The country is trash. You come into the country, and the airports, it's all trash, and there's one place that's good, though. It's like my clubs. You're like my clubs. No racism. It's beautiful. And you come in, so they're very nicely done, and they almost look like a Chinese airport or Dubai or something. But this very kind of the world, that's also very strange, very un-Republican, because Reagan's whole optimistic thing is gone. It's just it's trashing the country, except I trash the country and therefore I can save you. This also is very Machiavellian. What is a leader supposed to do? Moses. Moses was only able to lead the Hebrews, the Israelites, because they were oppressed in Egypt. So you have to be oppressed in order to find a leader. So against all the evidence in the world, Trump describes the United States as the most oppressive, crime-ridden, the economy's going down, we're losing more jobs, there's an immigrant tsunami, and all of these things, which are way exaggerated, crime wave, in order to be the savior. On the other hand, there's something about it. So this is an attempt to present himself as a savior by describing the situation as much worse than it is. On the other hand, he knows it's actually not so bad. And Machiavelli has a great line in the Discourses where he says, in a time of peace, basically, people choose as their leaders no longer people who are really talented, but entertainers. They choose entertainers because there's nothing serious happening. And in fact, if there was a war, then he could have never said about John McCain what he said. But it's actually because there is no war. There is no war, and there is no, that. This is a time of peace. Now, that leads you to ask the following question. What's going to happen if Donald Trump is elected president? And another very powerful Machiavellian point is that if you are put in power by people who are discontent, you better watch out. You better watch out. Actually, the way he puts this is very brilliant, and it's something we've talked about before with about Iraq. He said, never, when you knock over a regime, don't fire all the people who are servile and obsequious, because they'll be servile and obsequious to you. All those people who are just getting along, keeping their head down, doing their work, leave them there. They're going to do that for you. The people who bring you in, the people who are malcontents, they're going to like you for a minute. They're going to be malcontent with you because they're by nature malcontents. Those are people who are bringing, and they're going to, after a while, you're going to disappoint them. You're not going to build the wall. You're not going to stop all the immigration. You're not going to, as he said, in black neighborhoods, you walk out and you get shot immediately. As soon as I take over, all this will stop. There'll be no more shooting in Chicago as soon as I'm president. Well, this is not going to happen. So then what does he do when he disappoints people? He's been promising something, over-promising, and then he's there, and the people who brought him in, who are the discontents, they're not going to be satisfied, but they're going to be mobilized. He's going to be telling them, and you know, his supporters are, by the way, are armed. It's another Machiavellian theme. Any new prince will arm his people, and that's why they will feel loyal to him. Now, arming his people is redundant because they're all armed already. And this is a problem, however. And also, not only are they armed, but why are they loyal to him? That's also, I think, very important, and it's very strong Machiavellian point. He says, look, people are loyal to a leader if they feel like he cannot do what he's doing without them. Trump has no support in the Republican establishment. The only support is in these people, the followers, the people who are angry, this class of white male humiliate, whoever they are. They know he needs them, and therefore they think he's not going to betray them. But of course he's going to betray them because he can't do anything he promised. So he's up there. He has promised them things. He can't deliver. They are very confident that he will. So what happens then? Well, the answer has got to be he ratchets up somehow. He must do something to keep their loyalty. What is that going to be? And remember, the president of the United States, this is such a powerful position, you can easily create the justification for your action by your action. So if I can be very aggressive, let's say I torture terrorist suspects, or I kill the families of terrorist suspects, or I use a stop and frisk in black community, racial profiling and stop and frisk. What is, this is what it means, what I read at the beginning, he who does whatever he wants without any paying attention to the rules of law is crazy. It means, because rule of law is not just a limit that has abstract universal values, it has to do with acting strategically. What is strategic action? Strategic action means acting with a consciousness of how other people will react to what you do. So how will people react if you do stop and frisk, racial profiling, stop and frisk? Well, the obvious thing that's going to happen is you're going to poison community police relations. Police, the most important tool of the policeman is not the gun, but it's the informant. That is, people who are giving them information. And if you poison relations by picking up everybody's son, harassing them, they start looking at the police. So this is strategic thinking. It says don't do that. Don't plant weapons on people you arrest. You have to limit what the police do. You limit it because you're looking for a cooperative relation, which in the long run will reduce crime. This is a strategic thinking. So here's a guy who will do the opposite. That is, he will, you can imagine, there's a situation, let's just do a couple, think through a couple situations. He's been exacerbating racial tension in the country. There's a lot of guns in black communities too, as you know. And there's a situation where a policeman shoots a black kid, and then there a couple of black kids shoot a few policemen, and it goes back, gets into a spiral. And then you have a president of the United States who comes in and makes an inflammatory statement about this. So you could have a race war in the United States just by, and the more aggressive he acts, then there'll be aggressive response, and then he'll say, see, I should have been aggressive. Or you'll do something like, you blow an Iranian ship out of the water for no reason. Or because it was, they were sticking out their tongue at you or something. They were insulting us. Then they'll act very aggressively. And he'll say, see, I was right. Didn't blow their ship out of the water because look how aggressive they are. So you can create the justification for your aggression by your own. So this is why that position And I think in the case of relations with China, it's very possible that one of those Chinese planes that are swooping around our destroyers and naval ships will crash into a ship. And then this is a problem of how do you create a context in which it's possible for the other side to know how we are going to behave, because you don't have that long. You know that story about Jimmy Carter's presidency when Brzezinski was woken up at 3 a.m, he gets a phone call saying the Soviet Union is attacking us, there's a whole fleet of nuclear missiles headed toward us, and you have 6 minutes to send our fleet to destroy the Soviet Union. And so he puts, he's walking around in circles, another phone call, yes, it's true, they're coming, got 5 minutes left. So he's about to wake up Carter, and he gets called, no, it was a mistake, they were birds. So at 3 a.m, Donald Trump gets a phone call, and he has 5 minutes to respond. So this is, you can't consult Congress. You don't have the Supreme Court telling you what to do. You don't have public opinion. You have one person sitting on his bedside, groggy. This is a very, very dangerous thing to do, to have a person who's inexperienced, who is thin-skinned. And the thin-skinnedness, maybe I'll end with some things about that, because this is also another one of Machiavelli's main interests. He says, the leader you should choose is a person who doesn't become euphoric when he has good luck and doesn't become depressed when he has bad luck, who doesn't whine about his microphone if he loses the debate. You need a person who's very stable and who doesn't ever attribute his success, which came at least in good part from luck, to his merit. A person who says, the way I got here, everything I did, is because I'm so good. That would be a person, Machiavelli said, who is odious and who is hated. A person who can't admit that much of what they have achieved is due to luck. Where they were born, what school they got into, where their parents helped them, this kind of thing. And it's actually a sign of judgment and self-knowledge to be able to admit that much of what is successful, and of course that true is with other people, you can forgive yourself when you fail. It doesn't always because of you were incapable or incompetent. And other people too, you don't judge them and say, oh look, you failed, therefore I'm better than you because I succeeded even though my father gave me $14 million, this kind of thing. So this is a very strong, now the question is still hard to understand. I think that's correct. I think there is something unvirtuous about claiming merit, complete merit. And if you have no sense of luck, good and bad luck, you really don't understand the human experience very well, and you can't really sympathize with other people or be sympathetic to them. On the other hand, it doesn't register with many of these supporters, so that what he's promising, what he's able to give, I think is, what is this other thing? I want to reformulate it in a different way. And I want to use the phrase hypernationalism. I think it's a useful turn of phrase that can fit with populist parties in Europe and other places. A nationalist is a person who loves his country and defends it against enemies. A hypernationalist is one who looks for internal enemies. You look for internal enemies, and you appeal to solidarity, so we're all American, in order to demonize a part of your own population and say they don't belong here and they're not us. So that's this divisiveness, and this, of course I'm using Obama's phrase, but it is very divisive, saying these people aren't here, they don't belong here, they shouldn't be here. And I think the hatred of Obama, basically why is Obama so hated by many Republican voters? And I think he's the basic, not only is his mocking of Donald Trump the source of Donald Trump's ambitions, his basic achievement as president, and I think really all he wanted to do in a way, was to say America can be America even if we are a mixed race nation. And there are people in the Republican Party who says, no, if we're a mixed-race nation, we're not America. But, of course, we're already a mixed-race nation, America. So, therefore, that's a formula for violence. That's great. That's completely not a good way to look at things. But he's hated for that. He's hated more for that than, it's not a socialist. He's saying, is that we can be completely mainstream American and accept the fact that we're not going to be a dominant white nation anymore. And I think that motivation, and of course it's not rational, it has nothing to do with the real economic impact of immigration or any of these things, but it's a kind of touching upon some deep identity which wouldn't be so sensitive in a time of economic expansion. So it's really something that becomes neuralgic when you have economic contraction. So you can be on a boat, a small boat with 6 people or 8, 9 people of different social groups, and everything is fine until the food starts running out. then you become more sensitive to differences. And that's the kind of thing when there's a contraction, and which is what we're still in, even though the American economy is doing pretty well, really. I mean, compared, not for everybody, of course.
How would Machiavelli apply some of these principles to Hillary's candidacy?
Yeah, so one of the things is she was pushed by Bernie Sanders to flip on the trade deal. And Machiavelli says, never change your mind. If you're a politician, you can do the different thing, but never change your mind because you look weak. You look weak, you look like you can be pushed around and people can't count on you. So that would be his kind of, one of the things he would say about her critically, I think correctly. I mean, she's in a position, she was running in a primary, there was no enthusiasm for her, and we had an insurgent campaign. And let me use this as a moment to say something about that, which I think the Bernie campaign was fascinating for lots of reasons. But one of the main ones was that the Republican candidate is obviously a racist and a sexist. And Bernie Sanders' main campaign was that all problems stem from Wall Street. But Wall Street did not invent racism and sexism. It's like racism and sexism are deeper than economic class, and it's a different problem. But he wasn't sensitive to it, wasn't interested in it, actually. And actually, Wall Street likes Hillary and doesn't like Trump, in a way. They don't really like Trump. So attacking Wall Street was just attacking Hillary, not attacking Trump. So this was also, you can see, and they have similar things on trade, Bernie and Trump. And so that's a very interesting, that all the energy was in this, and Bernie too, with the foreigners, and they're kind of there's something threatening out there, and except he was, of course, cleaner. Because obviously not any whiff of racism in his analysis. But on the other hand, that was also a problem, because he would think all solutions for racism and sexism can be done by just addressing Wall Street, which can't be correct. I think that's one of the really, really shocking things about this season, how much energy there was behind him and how listless. I mean, she's a terrible campaigner, basically. She's a very intelligent, I mean, you know this as a person, she's a very intelligent woman and will be competent. Although, if she is elected, on January 23rd, the impeachment will begin. But, you know, sure, they're going to impeach her and they're going to spend the entire time in Benghazi and emails and all this thing. Nonsense things. Because why? Because they don't have any sense that, which was so strange, that talking down the president. I mean, the president of the United States represents the country. So you talk down the president. Like you say, Obama is weak. Obama can be pushed around. Obama is nothing. Has no backbone. You're telling this to the rest of the world, who are dealing with Obama, who's representing the United States. So it's, you know, what are they doing? Why that partisanship is so bitter that they can't, they have no sense that he is in a position to act to defend our interests. And you don't just dirty him every chance you get, you know, in any sense of this. And again, that's why you think maybe the party system, the whole system is collapsing. Because, you know, normally the way it works is, I don't like you. And by the way, it's also important that when you lose an election, you don't go to jail. I mean, otherwise you don't have democracy. Because then no one will leave. I mean, then that doesn't work. So you can't accuse the other side of being a criminal. That's just, and of course, there was many people who wanted to make criminal charges against Bush and Cheney. They committed war crimes, you could say, but that's an absolute taboo in a democracy, because if you start making criminal charges, when you lose an election, you go to jail, then democracy doesn't work. So you have to have a soft landing site for ousted incumbents. And in fact, the greatest argument for democracy historically, this is a more general political theory point, historically, you read the Bible, King David, King Saul and King David, for example, but it's historically, elites have competed for power, and when one elite faction takes over, they kill the other elite faction, the one that lost. They just kill them all. So democracy is better, you know, they can survive and they can go work on Wall Street and they can be TV announcers, and it's all fine. And you have a soft landing site, and that makes it function, because then you're not gonna call out the troops to shoot the other, where democracy doesn't work if when you lose an election, you lose everything, your children go to jail, all your property is taken away. That's not possible. So you have to have and you could say, well, that's not good because those people were actually criminals and you should charge them. Fine, that's a cost. It's a cost. You don't charge them, you have democracy. You do charge them, you don't have democracy. So this is, we're in a delicate moment now. Although I think the system is robust, the party system is there. I don't know about you, I'm feeling so nervous about this. I realized that watching that debate in the theater, just fearing the sense that there is a movement in the country that is willing to risk so much out of anger. Well, they're angry. And some of it, you got to address them somehow. I don't know that she's probably the best person to do that either. It's not about factual truth. It isn't about factual.
In prior elections, weren't these the people who stayed out, just didn't vote? These the people who were so disenfranchised? So
I think a lot of them. And the question is,
how is he mobilizing that group in a kind of threatening way?
Yeah, well, it's true. I mean, I don't know how many of the Brexit voters were people who'd never voted before. But I think it's correct. It's not, you can't think of those statements. When Hillary says something that's false, it really is false, because she's making a claim like, I never supported TPP or something. That's just not true. But when Trump says something like this, I didn't support the Iraq, he's not saying anything. I mean, it isn't really meant that way. And it's a grading on a curve. It's just that it doesn't, and he can't remember what he said even a few minutes ago. The climate change is a Chinese hoax. And when he says he'd ever said it, And I think in a way people are right not to judge it, because it doesn't have, it's more just a animal noise or something. But I think this phrase about law, since I teach in a law school, the phrase, he who can do whatever he wants, meaning act, if you can act outside the law with no reference to law, with no sense of inhibitions, you're crazy. The point is there that legal arrangements are a sanity check, a reality check. You have to have a reality check, a sanity check, when you're making decisions. You have to make decisions on the basis of facts of some kinds and arguments and listening to somebody else. And if you have a guy who can't possibly do that under any circumstance, who can't listen at all and has no attention span, you can imagine in the briefing room, trying to brief the guy in the morning. I mean, this is, all of you probably have a lot to do. You know, you get up in the morning, you have a lot to do. You can imagine being the president of the United States. It's like, it isn't a job for any human being. It's just an impossible job. And just the amount of information to which you have to react is just overwhelming. So having a person who can't, and he'll find somebody else to do these things, probably more than one. There'll be Chris Christie, there'll be Giuliani, there'll be, if Christie's not in jail, Newt Gingrich, or whoever, all these guys. And they'll be vying, and they'll be contradicting each other, and they'll be doing things it'll be very incoherent, because you need some kind of central system, which he's not going to pay attention to, obviously. And how his relation to Congress, what that's going to be, it's going to be, I think it's a very big, and maybe the most dramatic thing that's happened, though, is the consequence for the Republican Party of his winning, because they really depend on this. And it must be also as an imitative question. If you learn that you can run a racist, sexist, anger a candidacy and win, that's the United States is imitated all over the world. This is we are a model how you do things. So I think it's already been. We had the Berlusconi effect and so on. And there's more and more in Eastern Europe. Obviously, you're getting a lot of these nativist anti-globalization movements going on. So I think it's already an earthquake of a certain kind. So post factual. I think it's very striking to me how the TV has been so easy to play by this guy, who's he's a master of political marketing, whatever he is. It's like advertising science. You all know there's such a thing called behavioral economics, and it's basically nothing but advertising science, because advertisers have long ago realized that people aren't rational when they buy things. You can manipulate them, you can use various kinds of mind tricks on people. And he's just very good. He knows how to do this. He knows how to say things that touch buttons, push buttons. And a lot of these are emotional. This anti-woman thing, he'll say, and you'll think that's revolting what you're saying, but the people who support him, they don't mind it. They find it's refreshing or something. And so he's tapped into that. And I think for Machiavelli's line on this is, what do you do after you've made these promises? Because I remember another famous Machiavellian line is, you should coddle people, you should either destroy your enemy or others or coddle them. Don't go halfway. Either you're going to be treat people well, or if you want to hurt them a lot so they can't avenge themselves on you. You have to really kill them. Now, he's not going to kill all the, how is he going to deport the 50 million illegal immigrants? He'd have to hire illegal immigrants to drive the buses. I mean, what is he going to do? This is like impossible. He's not going to do that. So he's going to attack them, and they're going to be there. They're going to feel threatened. They're going to feel angry. They're going to feel hurt. They're going to feel humiliated. And same with stop and frisk. You humiliate people. You alienate them. That's a big rule in Machiavelli. You're going to attack people, really attack them, so they, like we did with the American Indians. So just kill them all, and then they can't. You can put the ones that remain in gambling casinos or something, but they can't do anything to you. But don't just hurt people a little bit. And then have them sit there and be angry at you. He's setting us up for a very bad time. And I think that the lack of truth is really part of this stronger thing that he's saying, you have a right to be angry, and I'm going to be your voice, and you may be armed, and that's going to be important.
Should she use that as an opportunity to go on the offensive and try to sort of destroy the Republican Party, or should she accommodate them?
No, I hope not. Yeah, of course, you're that's one of the, in fact, if there are a lot of things like this in Machiavelli, which you'll say, yeah, you have to really attack them. It occurred to me, too, that maybe what we need today is an institution like we had in antiquity, which was ostracism. You take a person who hasn't really done anything illegal, but you just vote to make him leave the country and put him somewhere else. And Trump seems like that kind of dangerous person. Of course, I'm just not, this is really serious. But I think it's going to be a responsibility for her, which I don't know if she's able to meet, but of her, and if she has a Democratic Senate, to figure out a way to help the Republican Party get back somehow some kind of stability. It's been so off the rails since the 90s, I guess, or even before. Now, this desire to impeach, the impeachment of Clinton was part of that. And the way they've treated Obama, basically try to stop everything, everything he's attempted to do. They've been obstructing it. They'll filibuster something for months and months and months, and then it'll be in the Senate. Then it'll be voted for 98-2 after they filibustered it for months and months and months. For why? What are they doing that for? Just says nothing. It's just purely obstructionist to make sure he doesn't succeed at anything, which is strange. So I think that's obviously, and Obama, of course, made them, the thing that makes him most furious about Obama is he kept trying for a long time to reach across the aisle and to be accommodating and to try to help them reach. That's made them really mad, because they said, no, you're our enemy. You have to, no, he wouldn't fight them. And then they would say, you see, he can't fight because he was too accommodating. But I don't know, I think it's, going after. The party's if he loses, the party, it'll be a shambles. I don't even know where the target would be. But it's an important question. How should a Democratic president act to a Republican Party that's in this condition?
How we have an anti-party system arising currently, and that clearly something is wrong with the relationship of the parties within the U.S. So I was wondering what your thoughts were on after the election, if you think this is possibly a turning point in the United States to move past a strong two-party system, or if you think that the Republican and Democratic parties allow enough flexibility within themselves to have these, you know, really drastic views, as an example, Trump, and still remain as one party?
I mean, I think it's a crisis. It's a crisis partly they brought on themselves by overpromise. He's a Frankenstein created by Fox News, in part, where there was always in Fox News kind of on the edges of racism, but not quite, and you know, building this up. And he's just outflanked them. And I assume that the people are right. If he loses, he'll set up a news. He already said, I'm building a hotel on Pennsylvania Avenue, so I'm going to be on Pennsylvania Avenue one way or the other. It's a very nice hotel, very nice hotel. Really, you should come see. So he'll set up a news organization with Ailes and Bannon and so on, who are, and be the leader of this kind of angry movement. And he can monetize it. I can assume that's what he's going to do. And keep things stewing. And that's going to be hard for the Republican Party, because how are they going to control that? They don't control Fox News either. And when you look at the Republican leadership, it seems so pathetic and unable to grip on this. The party system is in trouble everywhere. We saw this in Austria just recently, where the major parties, the ones who've been ruling the country alternatively since World War II, they lost out. I think together they have 15% of the vote or something, 20%. So you have strong anti-party. Feelings everywhere, anti-establishment feelings. And why exactly? And Brexit is that way too. So why? What's the source of it? And then if you destroy the establishment, you leave the establishment, what do you have? And the people in the establishment, the thing that was most amazing about Brexit is that, of course, that nobody predicted it. And that's because all of us, we live in our world. I mean, this isn't something new. I lived in Germany for many years. I never met anyone who knew Helmut Kohl, who voted for Helmut Kohl. No, you just live in your niche. You live in a world of people who are like you and talk to you, who have certain things that they... And this is a very strong sense that those who are being left out, who are voting, who are protesting, aren't communicating. The connective tissue... And this actually is a very big point about democratic theory, because under what conditions do social elites, political elites, do they act in a way that's responsive to ordinary people? And it can't be just voting as a way of making elites responsive to voting, because there are too many, there are economic elites and so on. So what is it? So it has to, there are many ways in which elites are sensitized. If you need a mass army to protect you from your enemies, then you probably treat ordinary people better. If you need workers who have to be literate, you send them to school and give them health care, because sick workers are no good. If you need consumers for your domestic production. So there are ways in which dependencies of elites on ordinary people support democracy, support voting. And when those erode, voting doesn't do much. And I think we're in that situation where democratic voting doesn't make... Citizens don't control politicians. It's just the simple that. Democracy is about citizens controlling politicians, but citizens don't control politicians. And that's a feeling of anger. It makes people angry. And I think this is around the world, feels this way. Elites are, there's this hovercraft elite phenomena. I notice all these guys in Silicon Valley are wanting to live on an island or build a colony on Mars or something. They're gonna want to get away. I think this is the major, it's a kind of a splitting off and a numbness and an unresponsiveness. And left parties, who used to represent workers in Europe, they don't want anti-immigrant feelings being part of their program. But of course, their voters have anti-immigrant feelings, so these voters don't feel represented by left-wing parties, and those voters are easily poached by right-wing nationalist parties. That's because they're saying things. And I notice, I mean, these are kind of just general global trends. The word toleration, which is a central liberal concept, has become, even here, because I live out in the countryside here, has become a word that means it's a class privilege. That is, if you are a middle class, a woman who needs domestic labor, or you're a factory owner who needs workers, you're for toleration. But if you live in the neighborhood with foreign immigrants who have knives and things like that, you don't like it. You feel like toleration is just an elite privilege, or universal citizenship. So what is universal citizenship? There are two conditions under which in Europe universal citizenship is possible. One is that every country in Africa becomes a country worth belonging to. It has really have governments that provide benefits for being a citizen. That's not going to happen. Or you can invite all Africans into Europe. I mean, I think sub-Saharan Africa is going to have 5 billion people in 50 years. And the pressure, demographic pressure on Europe is enormous. They're not going to invite them into Europe. It's not going to happen. So that means what you're going to have is two-class citizen. You're going to have some people who are citizens and some people who are not. We already have it, actually, now. And it's not universal citizenship. And if you don't have universal citizenship, you have something that's very illiberal and undemocratic. And you have demography that doesn't fit democracy. Democracy is not aligned with demography anymore. And so this is a huge issue, I think, in Europe particularly. The U.S. can handle this, I think, easily, except for the hysteria, which we're hysterical about the whole thing. But I think it's this relation between demography and democracy is a big one, because democracy doesn't represent the current demography. It represents an old demography. And that's one of the things I think Obama's contribution was to in some way try to bridge a gap. That's why this mixed race nation thing that he represented in his own mind made him feel like he didn't have to really do that much, like visit a prison or something. He didn't have to do much because he already did that.
After Brexit passed and it was decided that we were going to leave, Nicolas Farage, who was one of the leaders of the Leave campaign, announced that he was going to resign and exited the political scene really quickly. So I was just wondering if you thought Machiavelli would have supported his decision to resign.
I mean, it's a funny thing. Did he actually think this was going to happen? One of my friends said that this was Brexit was like that Broadway play, The Producers. Is that the one, Springtime for Hitler, where you do something you think it's going to fail, and then all of a sudden it's a success, and you're completely shocked by it. So I think there's a sense of I don't know. I want to be around for this because this was a protest vote. Turns out they were trying to protest, and then they did something. The protest was more successful than even they knew. I don't know about Farage particularly, but it seems like a kind of cheap running for the exits right before the collapse. So, and who knows what's going to happen? I mean, this is still open. Exactly the consequences, but it definitely is. It's changed the nature of Europe, and it's put it's not the same. Leaving the EU means the EU is no longer the same place that it was. So let's say Scotland wanted to join the EU, it wouldn't be joining the same place because it wouldn't be. Once Britain is out or England is out, then Germany's role is enhanced. It's a completely different situation. So that's another one of these international regime change things that's going on. My friends from Eastern Europe say it reminds them of 1988, 1989, when the elites, communist elites, kept doing, this is like Brussels today. Communist elites just kept acting as if everything was going to go on the same way because they couldn't really recognize, they're like not exactly partying on the side of the volcano, but going to office on the side of the volcano every day and doing the routine things, and the whole thing is shaking and about to collapse. But they couldn't really see it because they had their job and they had their office and they had their position and they had the things they were doing and everyone was going on in a routine-like way. But there's something cracking. There's like a tectonic shift that's going on. And people don't recognize it. And things can change very fast. We saw that in Turkey recently. Things can change like this. You can get a major remaking of a political environment that you and because we tend to think things, that's just the human being this way, none of it, people don't realize that they're all going to die. It's because you think things are going to go on forever the way they are, but that isn't the case. So people think things will go on the same way, and I think particularly a bureaucratic structure like the EU is a prime example of just not really knowing what to do. You just keep acting, and there's no responsiveness in the system. It's so rigid in the way it acts that it can't. It has no mechanism for dealing with the fact that it's collapsing, or that the European Parliament is full of parties that are against the EU. It's like a suicidal system. Thank you all. I was able.